Okay, we are now thinking about it. Okay, we are now live to the world. So, for everybody that's joining us for this live question and answer session, I'd like to welcome John Wills and Paul Grigio from the USA, all the way over there in the USA. Both were present during the, the cleanup operation at Eniwetok. For people who don't know where that is, it's in the Marshall Islands. So, could you first of all just introduce yourselves and who you are, and then I've got some questions for you, and then we will take questions from the public when they put them in the comments. So, can I ask you, John, just to introduce yourself first? And Paul? So could you just explain to me, I mean, I know what the mission is, but what the actual mission was within the Marshall Islands, what you were there, the overall mission was to do? Yes, yeah, it. Sorry, John, say it again.
That was 27 nuclear shots at several nuclear blast craters throughout the area. And one particular nuclear blast crater was from a nuclear weapon test codenamed Cactus. And that nuclear blast crater is where we decided to encase and to store the highest level of radioactive soil and debris. And we created what's called now the Ruined Dome, mm-hmm. as it was on Ruined Island. And so we left behind that, which is huge. It's a massive concrete containment dome that carry has 110,000 tons of nuclear material, you know, soil and debris.
So people will know the Marshall Islands. So, yeah, I'll come on to the dome, Don. People will know the Marshall Islands, yeah. In Britain, we know Christmas Island in the Pacific, because that's where the British did their tests, and Maldon Island. But the Marshall Islands is still within the Pacific. It's a group of islands. And can you just tell me the years that this cleanup was taking place? Because people in the UK assume, you know, it was 50s and 60s, but we're not talking 50s and 60s here. So the Marshall Islands, we know the Marshallese people were moved off the island and displaced from various locations. But you guys were tasked with an attempted cleanup. I'll call it an attempted cleanup of the island, because I know we've spoken before, Paul, about that it cannot be cleaned up. But you were there to scrape the soil and to attempt to clean up for this island.
Soil. And
So John, I know you were on ship. Yeah, carry on, John, sir. Yeah, we seem to get quite a lot of feedback from you, John. I don't know why. The fall seems to be okay, but we seem to get quite a bit of feedback from you. So I'm going to come to you, Paul, just while we sort out John's access there. So yeah, we seem to be getting some feedback. I don't know why we're getting feedback. Whenever you talk, John, we seem to be getting some feedback. I don't know why. That's a bit. That's better. No, it's still too low. I seem to be echoing in somebody's front room. So, Paul, can you explain to me, and for the people that are listening, the size of this dome? I mean, you can see it on Google Maps. You can see it very clearly. Just the size of this man-made structure and how it was made. That's okay. No, it's fine. You can do it in Imperial. You can do it in Imperial. It's fine.
The water wouldn't rise and fall with the tide if it didn't. Mm-hmm. And we never
and start bringing in the soil and so forth. And we never put any lining in the bottom. And I think that's what John was discussing earlier, is that we didn't line it. We just started dumping the nuclear material and soil right on the way it was. And then, you know, eventually capping it off with dirt, and then eventually putting the concrete cap on it. And so the dome today, of course, is leaking, but it's been leaking ever since we built it. It was never designed to it wasn't designed properly if the idea was containment. The crater next to it is about approximately the same size crater as what is now the dome. Mm-hmm. And so we can go on Google Earth, and it's easy to locate it. You locate the two craters, you locate the dome and the adjacent crater, which was from a nuclear blast test called La Crosse. And there you get an idea of the depth and the size of the crater we filled.
So just talking about that, the crater we're talking about is a concrete capped crater. Yeah. So
I met with the name of Tim that I had lunch with years ago, that was actually part of the guys that were the rock crusher doing the material in. And they said, oh, yeah, we put 500 barrels of Agent Orange. Now he passed away last 2 years. So I believe it.
So not only have you got material from the island, you've got material from the Nevada test site as well.
From that time period, trying to figure out why would they bring in all this soil. had submarines all over watching what was going on, and that they would be able to come back on an island that went wrong. And by getting all of these samples and what's there, they could reverse engineer the type of weapon or device that we were using. And so by bringing in soil, we would confuse them, and they would not be able to reverse engineer. And so it was a top secret safety type program. Because the other bombs would vaporize all of the components. And so once they were vaporized and they're 60,000, 80,000 feet into the atmosphere, it's very hard for the Soviet Union to I bet they tried, though, but they would be very difficult.
Yeah.
Well, one of those shots that also took the bomb, and they added, not inside the bomb, but extra material around the bomb. And when they went off, like Paul said, it smeared plutonium everywhere. From the farther northern islands to the southern islands. And that lagoon is 23 by 27 miles total. And when that went off, it was like, okay, it didn't vaporize.
Mm-hmm.
The plutonium just went out in a mass spec. Hold on a second, I got to take my teeth out here.
So, Paul, I want to talk to you about protection, okay? In the UK, they talk about protection and how much you had protection-wise in terms of suits, respirators, equipment, and really the conditions that people were working in, because it's obviously very hot there anyway.
Mm-hmm. And temperature hot, very hot. Our days, it's metric conversion. Our days, 100 degrees, with 100% humidity. There was no way to be able to wear protective gears. I can't help but let me take a step back. Like I saw John dealing with his teeth. That reminds me of something I didn't want to bring up.
Uh-huh.
Is that our drinking water.
Okay.
This radioactive contaminated soil into the lagoon, and that is the very same place where our drinking water was coming from. We had desalinization plants that were just pulling from both camps, from the Aniwetok camp and the Lozier camp, and we were just pulling our drinking water right from the same lagoon that was being resuspended. I mean, it was extremely negligent, and our harm is there's two isotopes. I mean, in particular, are cesium and strontium. Cesium is a metal that becomes liquid at room temperature and does not get filtered out with the desalination plant.
Okay.
And the other one is strontium. And strontium also is the same. It acts like a calcium, actually,
mm-hmm.
and dissolves and gets into our water. I know that because it involves radio calcium. Was in our water, and the strontium gets into our system. Our body, because it's an element that never existed in nature, our bodies don't have any idea what it is, and so our bodies believe that it's calcium. And so, because it's easier to absorb than strontium is easier to absorb. Our bones absorbed it, our teeth absorbed it, and we ended up having immense problems with our bones and our teeth in the years that passed. I, for example, have osteoporosis. Well, men, under the age of 65, less than 1% of men have brittle bones or bone, degenerative bones. In our group, geez, I'm an example. John's an example. We can go on and on.
Yeah.
Because we're way beyond 1%.
Mm-hmm.
I have 3 arthritis and osteoporosis, check my hips because I had another injection coming up in 7 days. They literally say, hey, you know, you've got the bones of a 93 or 95 year old man, and you're only 63 years old. What is going on here? And then I tell them where I served at, and they look at me and go, oh my God. I said, well, it's my fault.
So, Paul, a lot's been said about the dome and how it was made. But I've been told by the people who are on the island that you were mixing the sand to make the concrete with the sand that was on the island. So basically you're mixing irradiated sand to make the concrete. Is that the case?
Yes, absolutely. Let me step back to protections. Mm-hmm. Several things. It was mostly a field badge that he also had radiation badges, film badges. Okay. We did not do the film badges for the atomic cleanup, but I know about film badges because I did analysis on film badges at the laboratory for those who worked at the Nevada test site. Okay. And Rocky Flats and some other areas. So he never had anything referred to as 0.000 because of background radiation. Mm-hmm. So the U.S. government had a rubber stamp. I kid you not, we have the records. A rubber stamp that says 0.000. And they use that rubber stamp in lieu of functioning radiation badges, signature badges. And today, they used 0.00 radiation bad rubber stamp as our exposure. And that's one of our challenges, is that the government says we were not exposed, that we could have been in Mile High City of Denver and received the same amount of radiation, which is, well, come on, why were we there in the first place?
Yeah,
we
exactly.
were here for an atomic cleanup. We have 43 nuclear bombs and...
Yeah, go for it, John.
Wow.
So I've had a question for you, Paul. And it's from Greg, who says, with all we've learned so far about radiation, would it be assumable that the whole northern section of the atoll was hot?
Yes. The southern portion was also hot. When we're looking at the southern portions will be 180 miles away from Bikini Island. And when they had the nuclear shots in Bikini Atoll, those islands, and we talked to southern islands, the southern islands also had fallout. We have girls who lived on Anahuac Island during the testing in Bikini, and he speaks about 3 days of nuclear fallout falling on those islands. So all of the islands are somewhat contaminated, but the highest contamination is the northern islands, and that's also where they did the biological weapon testing. That's also where they did the rocket testing. They also did a number of other type of testing. Some of it's still classified today.
So the scale of this operation, how many people are we talking about were doing this operation? So we're talking 4,000 guys. How many of you are left? So, and you're talking how many that you know of that are left? Obviously, people you don't know that they're alive or not, but we're talking about an estimated number of ones that are still alive, do you think?
In a matter of months, we're going to have the exact number.
Fantastic.
Of how many of us are alive, but we're waiting on that at the moment. So, all of us are since we're going to know the exact number, my jelly bean count is we found roughly 635 survivors at this point.
Right.
And my guess is that's about a third of us. So my jelly bean count's about 2,100. We'll see if I get it right.
Okay.
When the study comes out.
I would say
Okay, so obviously, you know, the operation took place, and then you guys left. Was it returned back to the Marshall Islands?
Yeah, I mean,
sorry, John. So let's talk about where we're fast forwarding to now. Obviously, you left the island. The dome was capped off, and you know, off you guys went off to military careers, other careers, civilian careers, and off you guys went. But there's this talk of you being not being able to talk about what you did on that island. Could you just explain that to the guys in the UK?
Personnel, I had to sign a non-disclosure agreement traditionally, they never debriefed me. They never let me know that the dosimetry program failed. They did not let me know what I collected, what the samples were. They did not let me know what the results of anything were. So I had no idea of what I had actually collected. And it's very shocking. I gave an example. It's just a few days ago, maybe now a week and a half ago, I read a document that spoke about fragments of plutonium that were gathered up on one of the islands. And I realized I'm the one who gathered those plutonium fragments so that they could be analyzed. That was me who picked them up with my bare hands. I did not know that until a couple weeks ago. So that's 42 years I went without knowing what I had handled, and never been told, never been debriefed, never been explained what it was. And that's a scary part of what we're living with, because the answer to that is, we're only finding out now.
I mean, that to me, Paul, that is quite shocking, of that level of exposure for collecting samples, especially when you are collecting it for analysis, to be told 40 odd years later that there's all this stuff here that you were collecting. I mean, that is quite frightening.
Transcribed into the text. And one thing I didn't mention in my handwritten notes is that I kept one of those fragments.
Right.
It was beautiful. It was like a melted crystal with metal fragments inside it. And it was so pretty that at that time, I'm not yet 21, and I wanted to make a pendant for my high school sweetheart. So I could give her that pendant. And fortunately, that didn't happen. But however, when I was getting ready to finally leave the atoll, I had a collection of various items that I had that I was going to take home. When one of the scientists, a nuclear physicist, literally said, "What the hell are you thinking? You can't take any of that back. You're crazy." And he demanded I get rid of it. Mm-hmm. And so. Which brings up another problem. How do you get rid of plutonium? Mm-hmm. And so I got rid of it. Now, I don't remember how, but it was such cool. And by that time, I don't know how we talk about it. We talk about, hey, Adam, we talk, is it contaminated? Well, I know one thing. There's this beautiful piece of plutonium that I had to get rid of. I'm afraid. I have nightmares thinking that maybe some other young man picked up, or maybe I gave it to him, I don't remember, picked that up and gave it to his high school sweetheart. Mm-hmm. Now, that would be a piece of jewelry. You hear sometimes these things about, this Egyptian piece of jewelry and the curse it has. Well, this is a true, true nightmare. If it were turned into a piece of jewelry, if somebody did what I wanted to do, and they did that piece of jewelry would have been death to every single person, every single generation it would be passed down to. It would be truly a curse.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Spots that were cables and conduits for the nuclear explosion.
shots and vaporized it. And that island is about 8 to 10 feet higher than any of the other islands because the atolls are generally very flat. Mm-hmm. And I thought, wow, this is just the way it is. It's a, geologically, that's how this particular island was. Well, only to find out that, that was 8 to 10 feet of nuclear fallout.
Wow.
From the other blast. And that's what I was digging in. And that's what, and it was a nesting ground for birds. Those were migratory birds. And I, it's just a concern after concern after concern to finally, it's fear. Mm-hmm.
So talking about the dome now, obviously we're in 2021. And, you know, the dome, we've talked a lot about climate change on the internet and everything else, and the dome cracking or the dome leaking. We've already said it's been leaking since you built it. So what are the concerns from you guys, knowing what's in there that built it, were around at the time, around the future for that dome?
The atomic family.
contaminated water out of a lagoon that they were resuspending strontium. Yes. Well, then the two of those together, a medical professional would say, well, that is major problems.
Yeah.
The causation, not the diagnosis, the causation. And here in the United States, we have 1 million, I checked it out on the internet, approximately 1 million medical professionals. And I cannot find one in a million that would help us. And I'm hoping to reach out and mention that, like in this format that you're giving us, that we know that helps. Mm-hmm.
I also want to mention there's a filmmaker by the name of Brian Cowden, who calls a friend of mine. I asked him a couple of years back, I go, what is your situation in this? He goes, I want to prove that all these nuclear blasts, now they're globally, we've had almost 2,800, maybe a little bit more, of nuclear blasts throughout the world. That's from 1945 on. He says, do you ever wonder, as far as global warming, where the line or the chart has gone? I go, I've never thought of that. He goes, check it out. It's actually one of the causes, major causes of global warming. Because the stuff is still up in the atmosphere. There's still stuff from IV Mike floating around up in the atmosphere because it was so hot and so intense. So that degrades the degree of the planet even hotter than it already is. And what people don't understand is the water from Anawita and from Fukushima is going circling, this whole thing is circling around the planet because that's what salt water does. It goes in a current from south to north, cools back down, and comes back down. And it's a fact. I hate to say that corny movie I always watch, The Day After Tomorrow, but basically that's exactly how it plays out. Luckily, we're still probably not at the turning point, but we're getting awful close. I don't think we can ever mess with it. I think we let the genie out of the bottle, per se. And now it's time for all of us to wake up, including our government. Because, wait a minute, if we have all these medical issues going on, and we can't prove it otherwise under medical science or medical fact, and you're saying, no, you weren't there, or no, it wasn't caused by that, then how come anybody else in my family is walking around, talking, I'm just 7 years older than I am, she has no medical problems like that. She has a little bit of skin cancer, but she doesn't have anything like I got going on. Neither do any of my friends. You know, Paul and I have basically almost the same kind of illnesses. The stomach illnesses, the teeth issues, the bone issues. It's crazy. Then how can we have the same issues? How can most of all the guys again we talk to Paul have all the same kind of medical conditions? And the government's going, well, you know, this is because you're old. But it's like, wait, you're making a narrative that doesn't make sense. You're not putting scientists on that with medical examples. So,
going forward then, Paul, obviously, you know, we are in 2021. You know, I know there's lots of bills going through Parliament and there's lots of discussions over which bill's better and that sort of thing going through your Senate and the House. It's different over here than it is over in the States. I know, yeah, your politics is a little bit more complicated than ours even, in terms of House and Senate and bills and things. But just explain that to the people that you are excluded at the moment from RECA. You're not involved in RECA at all.
There's three programs here in the United States. Let's start there. There are three programs. There's the Atomic Veterans for Military Personnel. There's the Radiation Exposed for DNA, for DOE personnel. Okay. If you're with the Department of specific health checks and every 2 years follow up, and then they have a program where they can make a determination of your illnesses and have a compensation program. Then the third is RECA, and predominantly, with exception of uranium workers, predominantly that is for downwinders. That is for the communities like those in outside of the Nevada test site or outside of it's kind of like tobacco. It's those are the secondary smoke. You know, not the smokers themselves, but the person who is secondary.
Who's on the same
and so with that is much different. And so the RECA program wouldn't cover the type of medical, wouldn't cover the type of illnesses, wouldn't cover anything, because I'm a radiation worker.
Mm-hmm.
And the DOE program would, and I worked under the DOE. However, the DOE says you had to be there prior to 1962. It has a cutoff.
Okay.
1962, which coincides with the atmospheric nuclear testing. Well, that is exactly the same language that the atomic veterans military personnel are up against.
Yep.
It's a matter of fact, word for word, it's the same language. They made the language for qualifying for an atomic veteran and qualifying for the DOE program identical. So they say, okay, 1962 cutoff for military personnel, 1962 cutoff for non-military radiation workers. Then the RECA program is again more of a downwinder, but it does have compensation. And so that's pretty much, you know, the secondhand smoke or the radiation worker program. So those are the three programs that we have today. There's going to be a bill introduced to Congress again, which is called the Parity Act.
Mm.
And it's named after a congressman in Hawaii that took a passion and interest in us. And it's going to be reintroduced for the fourth time. Now, in the United States, we have 2-year sessions of Congress. So it's been in Congress for 6 years. And it's now going to go into Congress again, so for 4 years. Unfortunately, from the last Congress and the previous Congress, we lost 83 co-sponsors. Ooh. And so the fear is that there's not an appetite in our Congress to listen to us, especially when we're fighting a false narrative about not being exposed.
Mm-hmm.
That DHRA has, you know, constantly doing, because the Veterans Administration gets their information from DHRA.
Mm-hmm.
And the DOE administration gets their information from DHRA.
Okay.
And so they're looking at, well, you know, gee, why do you even need a program? Because there are radiation worker programs that a radiation exposed veteran that doesn't have to be considered an atomic veteran. They can make a claim today and receive compensation and health care for an illness. But there's that catch-22. Where's the causation letter?
Mm-hmm.
And especially difficult if they're going to the Veterans Administration for their health care. Well, the Veterans Administration health care is not going to, they're not going to write a causation letter, because they know what that means, or nexus, as it's called in the military, causation in the civilian military. So that's where the problem. And the Atomic Clarity Act is to be able to have 22 of the illnesses considered without having a causation letter.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the CDC now has 62 illnesses that are related to radiation exposure.
66.
And now it means that even if the 22 are recognized, the others are not, you're back into the situation where you need causation, and it seems to be impossible. personnel. Okay. It excludes non-military personnel such as me. And unfortunately, it's the same exact language. It's the same exact DITRA. I was in the same location. I lived on the same base. I even wore the same uniform, pair of shorts. unfortunately, I guess it leaves me alone on my situation. For many though, non-military personnel, they were a career in the atomic industry, and so many of them are able to get health care and get coverage because they worked somewhere else that okay. is covered, and so that even drops it down to where there's fewer of men like me because they're able to find health care. For me, I abandoned my career in the atomic industry for many reasons, and one of them was actually there at the atomic cleanup. Because I left very, very concerned about my health, very concerned about what I experienced. I mean, I even wanted to forget about it so that I wouldn't have nightmares or worry about it all my life. And I can go on about that. There's other aspects that are the reason I quit my career in atomic industry.
I've got a message here for both of you from John Laramie. He says he's at work on a roof in Vermont, but just wanted to say hello and thanks so much, men and brothers, for all you do. Kathy has just asked whether we touch base on the cubic feet of nuclear waste brought over from Nevada test site. But we did that. We did talk about that. Yeah, we have the same thing in the UK that soil was taken from Christmas Island and brought back to the UK and dumped in a place called Middlesbrough. And the only radioactivity in there was from the dials of the machinery. And that's the only radioactivity was there. And yet you brought it all the way back. So... Is it my speaker? Wow, there we go. It's my speaker.
Well, you got that figured out.
an hour and a half in. Kathy's asking what the concrete mixture of the dome itself made with radioactive waste. We did that, didn't we? We used that.
Well, let me pick up. It wasn't just sand, but it was an aggregate plant. And what they did to get the aggregate is that they went into the coral reef itself on the ocean side and blasted the coral reef and then ground it up and actually made aggregate out of the radioactive. And from back to Google Earth, because I love that, you know, now that anyone can go there and look at it, it's no longer secret as it mm-hmm. once was. Take a look and you can see where in the coral, the little square, little triangular areas where we blasted and took that out.
Cement mixture that came in sacks was actually what was called the six salt, the six sack. It's a fast acting cement. It can be used with a salt water mixture instead of just fresh water. Normal cement is mixed with a fresh water base. They made special six sack, which was fast drying, and they made it so it would take up the salt water to the tension, and when they had the aggregates mixed in with that, that's what you had.
Yeah, so Jonathan not only brought the beer, he brought the concrete.
He brought the concrete, yeah. So...
well, that beer part's very important. And it was a concrete. But anyway, so the concrete was mixed with seawater. And so that's why there isn't any rebar in there. Had we put rebar to reinforce the concrete, it would have been eaten up by the salt. And so that, if wondering, well, how come there isn't any rebar in there? Well, it's a good thing there isn't.
So I'm the president of the United States, and you've got an audience with me, okay? What if you could get an audience with your new president? What would you say to him? What would you say? What needs to be done?
Well, anybody that our DNA that got screwed up.
So, yeah, from my point of view, I'm a descendant. My father's no longer here. Yeah, he died a long time ago. It severely affected our family. It severely affected my mother. My brother died 18 months later, very young. Yeah, it's affected us, and it affects generations down. Our view at Lab Rats is this is global, this is international. This is affects everybody. And it's not that it was a test 60, 70 years ago. It's not that it was a cleanup 43 years ago. As you said, Paul, you hit nail on the head when you said that the half-life of plutonium means that it's like it was yesterday. And I think that's the message to people is that, you know, I get quite a lot of people say, well, look, there's a bunch of old veterans stood there. Yeah, they're just a bunch of old veterans. But it's more than that. It's a bigger picture than that. It's a global picture. As Brian says, it is global. It is a global picture. So what can we do, Paul? You're an expert in this field with soil samples and everything else. What can be done? Can anything be done? I mean, you talk about the half-life of that. Have we got the technology to do anything with it?
Since he first discussed it, there still isn't any money in it. There isn't an industry in it. So the idea is to simply bury it in a hole somewhere, in a cave somewhere, in a salt bed somewhere, and try to forget about it. And there's now a time that there needs to be funding for science, and so that we can have the tools and the technology to be able to deal with this radioactive material. Lots have changed in the 80 years, in the 75 to 80 years. We have robotics now. We have DNA research. We have the ability, but it's not being funded because we don't have the industry for it. $96 billion in a Hanford cleanup. And if I just take back 43 years ago when we did this cleanup, all we did 43 years ago, we clean up, it's a misnomer. We didn't have soap and water and go over there and clean up anything. All we did was move it around. Mm-hmm. And today, all they're doing is moving it around. Mm-hmm. Yet, they're talking $96 billion to move it around. That is a problem. I think what we can do today is stop any ideas of cleanup and deal only with containment and deal with what are we going to do with it? What are we going to do with this radioactive material besides leave it to the next generation and the generation after that and so forth and so on? So that's my hope, is instead of a cleanup industry that exists, that they would take the existing resources and put it into our scientists, our universities, and create the incentive to be able to properly deal with nuclear material.
You know, as the presidents have gone on, they've had different they've had start treatments where you limited the amount of nutritional material and the amount of moms you had. The problem is they still are making the same bombs. They made them smaller, they made them more powerful. What they need to do is just stop and figure a way to get this illicit material, the only way I can say about it, is get it off the planet. Figure out some way to destabilize the world where it goes back to nature. But you know, when you make plutonium, you're taking a regular reactor, and then the byproduct is plutonium. And they've made so much of it at Hartford and just in my own backyard, a place called
yeah, I mean, I'm a great advocate for removing the nuclear weapons completely from the planet. Because as Paul put it so eloquently, the genie's already out of the bottle. You've already lifted the lid. You've already done the damage. The damage is irreversible. You can contain the damage, but it's irreversible. And we never want it to see it ever done again. So, guys, we've been going for an hour and a half already, which is amazing. Speed through. Is there anything else you'd like to add to this conversation before I say thank you very much? Because what you've given is such an insight into actually being there and experiencing it.
Legacy before us. seeing it happen right now. This conversation we're having is the same as that. You know? When you see the marginalized people, like I saw them, Paul and I were at a women's group, and they're lovely people. I mean, they gave up their whole country or their whole atoll so we could come there and blow bombs on it. But, you know, the problem was, they didn't give it up. They got talked out of it. And then, move somewhere else. Oh, we'll take care of you. Oh, by the way, now you can have that back. It's highly radioactive. You don't want to be there. So you come to the United States and have your community there, but you have no security, you have no evidence. You're kind of at a disadvantage for everybody in the population. It's really sad because there's so many, such a good people. And we have people around the world like that in different countries. We just have to give them a chance. Time to stop the nuclear war.
Yep.
Time to stop the nuclear advancement and say, you know what? Let's put our advancement into our kids, to their minds, so they can figure out these problems. Because obviously we're old guys, you know?
Yep.
They're going to have to leave the way.
So, from my point of view, it's stop the denial is the big thing for me. Stop the denial. Admit the mistakes of years gone by and work together to find a solution. Well, guys, I wanted to say, I've just had one last message from Doug Schillerhall, saying thank you very much for continuing the awareness, which is fantastic. So it's been great to talk to you. It's been fascinating. This will get shared across the world. So let's hope that we can do some good and work together and finally get you guys the recognition you deserve and the help you deserve and everybody else that needs it. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you.